where we read verse number 25. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? So Jesus was not very happy with the crowd there. Now, we were talking about crowd and intimacy during the newer message time. And I'm going to talk about a theme which is in line with what we spoke on 31st night. Crowd was following him, but Jesus was not happy with them. Now, Jesus was making a kind of a complaint, or he was rebuking them in one way or other way, that he says that you, crowd, you know, you're following me because you just want material blessings. Verse 28. You just are concerned about food, and that is why you're following me. And again, in verse number 30, he says that you're following me just because you want to see miracles. See miracles. And then again, verse number 28, Jesus says, you're following me just to ask questions, reason, and have critical, you know, questions, and just want to be more judgmental. That is why you are following me. And so I am not very happy with you. That is what Jesus is trying to say. Then what does Jesus want? Why should the crowd, or what should crowd do to please Jesus? As you see in verse number 26. You're looking for me just because of these things. And that's natural. Everywhere you see all kinds of people like that, they are only for material blessings. Only for, you know, healing. These are all needed. Only for being judgmental. But what Jesus needs the most is not just following him for the sake of all these things, but what he wants for the crowd to do, or for the people of God who are here for 2020, is intimacy. He had crowds following, 5,000, 6,000, 10,000, but he had only 12 who were with him all the time. In other words, only 12 of them were intimate with him. They were not just for material blessings, but to have something different from Jesus. Now, how does Jesus talk about, what is the way Jesus, how is he explaining about intimacy there? There are many ways we can be intimate with Jesus, but based on the story here, we read that he is saying that in verse number 27, that you need to partake of something to develop intimacy and to have God's approval. Only then you can be intimate with me. Whose intimacy do we want today? Do you want to be intimate with our friends? Good enough. With our family? Good. Church members? Good. But more than all those, Jesus wants us to be more intimate with him in 2020. Whose approval do we want? Man's approval? Pastor's approval? Your boss's approval? More than all, we want God's approval. That's what you read here, you know, in verse number 27, last part. So what should we do to be intimate? To partake from something, to eat, to enjoy something. And we read in verse number 53 of the same chapter, Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. That means to partake from something which Jesus is trying to give it to them. He is trying to tell them that there is a real bread which I want to give you. They were looking for bread, but Jesus is saying, I'm going to give you real bread. We read that in verse number 30 onwards. We read it there. We come to that in a few minutes' time. So my topic of my message today will be the real bread that brings intimacy. The real bread that brings intimacy. The first thing which I want to bring is the identity of the real bread. Verse number 33. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Jesus is using that phrase, real bread. What is the identity? What are the different names and phrases used for bread of God? Or you can say the real bread. You know, verse number 30, we read it as bread of God. It is compared with the manna given in the Old Testament time. You read the context, you know that people are saying that in the Old Testament, Moses provided them with manna. And Jesus is contradicting that statement, saying it's not Moses who gave, but your Father in heaven who has given the manna to you. And verse number 32, again, another phrase is used, bread from heaven. I'm just looking at those phrases. And when you come to Psalm 78, verse 24, you read another phrase used there for the bread that came from heaven, the grain of heaven that you see there in verse number 24. And when you come to 25, Psalm 78:25, it is written as bread of angels. All these are various phrases which are used for the true bread. And Jesus himself says, it is the true bread that came from heaven. So what I'm trying to say is, what is this real bread? This is something that came from heaven. Or you can say this is heaven's product. And if it is heaven's product, it is pure and faultless. That means nobody can find any fault in this bread which is coming from heaven. There is no defect. All the bread we buy will have some or other defect, or at least have an expiry date. But this doesn't have any defect that comes from heaven. This bread is genuine and trustworthy because it is heaven's product. That means anybody can trust that. You know, some people when they go to the, when you talk about food and all, they said, I don't eat this kind of food because there is lactose in it. I don't eat this food because there is sugar in it. I don't eat that because there is salt. I have blood pressure and all kinds of things. Now, there are some or other defects in some or other food because we have different bodies and we are restricted by doctors to eat this and eat not that. But this food can be trusted. There is no fault in it. It is very genuine. And is the highest quality food, unmatched with anything. It is better than the food you ate in Egypt, because people of Israel, when they were in the wilderness, they would say, we were eating, you know, what is that, watermelon and lessons and leeks and I don't know, all kinds of food. But it's better than that, which God is providing you from heaven, the manna. It is better than Nebuchadnezzar's palace food. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, they were given the best food in the palace. But said, we don't want that because we are having something else. Just give us plain food. We don't want those food there. It is better than that. It is better than the kosher food, right? You ask Jewish people, they eat only kosher food. If you ask a Jain in India, it's better than the Jain food. They have special canteen for them. You know, even in the airplane, in the train, they have special food. And to make it more practical for us, it is better than organic. Then you will understand. You all go for organic food, right? Oh, this is organic and that's more expensive. But this food is better than organic food. Unmatched, uncomparable. But the question is, who is this real food? My time is short, so I'm running fast. Who is this real food? Verse number 32 and verse number 35, we see Jesus says, what does he say? I am that bread. I am that true bread of life. In verse number 42, what does he say? I came from heaven. Verse number 48, what does he say? I tell you the truth, he who believes, I am the bread of life, which came from heaven. Again, all those places, Jesus say, I am the one which was given to the people of God in the Old Testament. One way or the other way, This true bread is uncomparable. Who is that? Jesus cannot be compared, matched with anybody. Nobody can compare with Jesus. Isaiah 40 verse 25 says, who can compare with this God? Nobody can be compared with. He is worthy to be praised and adored. That is why we sing praises to him. No comparison with Jesus. No comparison. He is the faultless one. There is no fault in him. Sinless, born of virgin. No fault in him. Neither the Jewish nation, nor the Roman emperor or the government could find any fault in him. The most powerful deciding body was the government, the Roman government. Pilate says, I don't find anything in him to be worthy of to be killed. He is faultless. Even the centurion, when he was looking at Jesus before he died, he said, he is a righteous man. That is told of nobody. Only for Jesus. And above all, he is genuine. He is trustworthy. Your friends may fail, your family may fail, your people may fail, but you can trust him all the time. Even the doctors may fail, even the medicines may fail. There are a lot of doctors sitting here. Appreciate them. Even the medicines may fail. We have duplicate medicines also coming up in some part of the world. I don't want to name that place. Duplicate medicines are there. You can't trust anything now. You know, even poison is not to be, cannot be believed. You know, in India, you give poison to kill some, you know, rats or anything, they won't die. They eat and they come back fat. Nothing can be believed. Nothing can be trusted. But Jesus can be trusted. Hallelujah. This afternoon, I want to tell you, you might have tried everything. You might have failed. But Jesus says, I will never let you down. Hallelujah. Daytime, nighttime, afternoon time, while driving, while inside the sanctuary, outside the sanctuary, you can trust him, you can call him. He is there, right there. Now, let me move to the second point, which is the message which is connected to us this afternoon. The partakers of the real bread. Who are supposed to partake from this real bread? Now, before I tell you, we need to know the expectations about the partakers. If Jesus is faultless and sinless, he expects those who are going to partake from this bread should be sinless. Pastor, that is a difficult thing. Yes, that is difficult. But through the blood of Jesus, we can be sinless. I cannot be holy all the time, but I can plead the blood of Jesus. I can cover myself under the blood of Jesus, and I will be cleansed then and there. With the help of the Holy Spirit, I can lead a victorious life, though I may fail, but the Holy Spirit will never fail us. We need to rely on him. We need to trust on him. And the partakers are supposed to be genuine. In other words, pure in heart. We try to be pure in heart, right? There are many who partake from the Lord's table without a sincere heart. From outside, they may be nice, but inside, full of filth. That's why Jesus looked at the Pharisees and said, you are whitewashed tombs. You look good outside, but inside there is dirt. But blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they shall see God. That is what God wants from us. We may not be smart, we may not be intelligent, we may not be much educated. That's okay. God doesn't look at all those things. These are all good things. But what good God looks at is our genuine heart. If we come with a repentant heart, a pure heart, a broken heart, he will definitely bless us. He will be close to us. Bible says he's close to the broken heart. And those who partake from this, because this is real bread, the real bread or the real genuine ones are very expensive, right? In India, whenever we buy something, if it is made in outside India, whichever nation it is, we say foreign. It's a, you know, so there's a big demand for that, right? They don't look for the quality of the shirt, but just the label where it's made in USA, made in so-and-so, we go and buy that. Because they expect that those clothes are high standard clothes, right? Even though there are holes here and there, but made in some other country makes it very high standard, right? That's what you used to think there. Only after coming here, I realized there are different things there. So if that is true with the things of this world, how much more is true for the real bread? If the real bread that has come from heaven is high standard, God expects high standards from us. You understand my point? Our walk, our talk, our behavior, our everything should be in line with what Holy Spirit wants. And what is the result of such partaking? Such people, Jesus would not look at them and said, I tell you the truth. You are looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Verse 26. He will not say like that. Such people, he will say, that I am pleased with you. I look for such people, such genuine people. I want to have an intimate relationship with you. I tell you, God is always for us. You know, Peter denied him how many times? If we were there in Jesus' place, what would we have done? Come on. We're thrown him out. You fellow, you had food with me for 3.5 years and finally you betrayed me 3 times? Denied me 3 times? But because he repented, he genuinely asked forgiveness and there was reconciliation. Hallelujah. Jesus says, I forgive. I know you will do that. I know your weakness. But still, if we come to him with a genuine heart, he is ready to forgive us. He wants to have a genuine, intimate relationship with each one of us. I want to tell you, 2020, God is going to have a genuine relationship with many of us. How many of you believe that? An intimate relationship with each one of us. He wants to bless you. He wants to bless your children. He wants to bless your spouse. He wants to bless your family. He wants to bless your church. And that's the deepest desire of the Lord. And above all, he would say, as in verse number 27, he'll say, upon him has the Father's approval. Seal of approval. He looks at you and me and says, I approve you. I approve you. The government may not approve you. Your friends may not approve you because they look outside. But the Lord who looks inside is ready to approve you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Our God is not like the government of this world or the people of this world. Because even Prophet Samuel misunderstood, right? Looking at the height and the weight of the boys, he said, this could be the king. God said, no, not the first one, not the fifth one, not the seventh one. There's one in the wilderness. God says, I approve him. This morning, the Lord wants to approve you and say that you are my daughter. You are my son. You are my child. You are not alone. I am with you in the times of difficulties. Let this 2020 be an year of an approval for many of us. Else, I want to tell you, let us have a genuine heart. And let us have a genuine walk with him, an intimate walk with him. He will walk with us. Let's take one step, he will take 2 steps. If we are ready, he is more than willing. If we are just say, Abba, Father, he says, yes, my daughter, yes, my son, here am I. What do you want me to do? I was happy when I saw the children's reciting verse. Even Ruthi wanted to say verse. I was happy because she told me, I want to recite. Because 2 days back, I was told that she's afraid to come and say the verse. But look at, when we desire, God honors that desire. And that is what true with all the children, even Sarah and other children. Everyone is precious for Jesus. I believe that this year will be an year of intimacy. This will year will be an year of revival for us. This will be year an year of anointing. That's the theme of this year's retreat. Are we ready to trust in Him?